Man. Give the Lord praise this morning, church. Man, we're going to take a different approach this morning. Amen. I want you to go with me to the book of John, chapter 14, verse 15. Amen. Hallelujah. There's a quote by Charles Spurgeon. Amen. And I'll open up with this quote from Charles Spurgeon. And he says, "It's astonishing how many difficulties clear up without any effort when the inner life gets straightened out." You know, I remember my dad told me when I was very young, because you have those, you know, in life you have those wild kids, or maybe you were one of those wild kids, you know, somebody that you couldn't tame, you know what I mean? Like a stallion out there, an animal that's untamable, but it's beautiful. It's a beautiful creature, but you know what I mean? Man, you can't do nothing with it because, you know, it's untamable. It's just wild and crazy. And you know, and Charles Spurgeon, you know, says it quite clearly there. He goes, "It's astonishing how many difficulties clear up without any effort when the inner life gets straightened out." You know, when we begin to get things straightened out, when we begin to, you know what, get our priorities right. You know, my father always told me, he said, "You know what, son?" He said, "Life is so simple," because I was one of those troubled kids. He said, "All you got to do is follow the rules." You know, you may not like the rules, son. You know what? You may not agree with the rules, but rules are rules. And you know what? Life is so much simpler as long as you follow the rules. You just got to follow the rules. And in John chapter 14, verse 15, it says, "If you love me, you will obey my commandments. Si ustedes me aman, obedezcan mis mandamientos." You will obey my commandments if you love me. I want to talk to you this morning about benefits. Benefits. There's benefits, amen, not only for you and I for serving God, but there's benefits for the Lord. Now, we've been talking about the wilderness and going into the wilderness and dry places. And you know what? What does it benefit the Lord for us going into the wilderness? Well, it benefits God by many things. And that's why God chooses to take us to the wilderness. Why? Because when God takes us to the wilderness, it's not about us and everybody else. What happens is God chooses to take us to the wilderness, amen, to begin to bring intimacy into our lives. See, Lord, the Lord wants to be intimate with you. And a lot of times, you know what, we think about intimacy in the way that we've been taught it. And we think about it, you know, maybe, you know, when you're young, you know, it's gross. Then you're, you know what I mean, you're a teenager because you're thinking of it in a worldly way because you're burnt, you know, it's just crazy. But we can't think of intimacy in that way. We have to think of intimacy with God as a relationship, a complete relationship. You know what, somebody that listens. Somebody that cares, you know what? Somebody that doesn't, you know what, care about himself, but cares for you, that dies to self constantly because he loves you so much. And you know what? That's what the Lord wants to do with us in our lives. Because we're so busy, you know what, in all the things that we do, but the Lord wants to have intimacy with us. He wants to teach us the importance of intimacy. And intimacy takes place in the wilderness. And he says, "If you love me, you will obey my commandments." So why did God take the children of Israel into the wilderness? To teach them how to trust in him. This is what obedience is, church. See, obedience is trust. It's not something that you're forced to do. It's not something that you have to do. It's something that you want to do because you love and you trust an individual so much because of his faithfulness. Amen. Did you know, church, that God loves you so much this morning that he chooses to take us into this wilderness time that we're at right now? You know, we're going through tough times. I don't know if you see it all around the world, but you know what? God wants to get intimate with his people. You know, you got to be careful watching all this Skynet and this prophecy channels and all these things, these guys in Proféticas and all this stuff, man, because, man, they're looking at the ways of the world and they're trying to place them into the Bible and configure everything and make people check it out. You know what? Stop being so stupid, and why don't you just open your eyes and get the eyes of Jesus and realize, you know what? That, yeah, he's shaking the foundations of the earth, but you know what? He is coming soon. But why is it? Because he wants to have a relationship with you. He wants to get intimate with you and I. You know what? The church has been dead for so long. You know what? We're going through rituals, you know what? And we're just going in and out and playing church. You know what? I love you, Lord. I love you, Lord. But you know what? It's not about saying I love you, because how many of you know that we tell our wives and our kids and friends and family every day, I love you, but it's meaningless. It's meaningless without intimacy. Why? Because it's just a word. If there's nothing else behind it, it's just a word. Intimacy doesn't care about itself. Intimacy dies to self. You know what? And now that we've given our life to the Lord, you know what? We're called. We're called to not only die to self, but you know what? We're called to become intimate with God. You know, we were out there, you know what, Lord, I don't want to live like this no more. I don't want to be like this no more. I don't want to do this and I don't do that. And God says, here I am. Amen. Let's get intimate. Amen. Let's build a relationship. You know, all those bottled feelings and everything that you hold up inside that you can't talk to nobody about, you can talk to me about them. Amen. You know, all those feelings that you've been holding on to, you know what, guess what? You can lay them down at my feet and I'll give you rest and I'll give you peace. But see, we got to get intimate with God so that way we can understand, you know what, exactly who he is. You know what, his desire is to strengthen our relationship with him. That's another reason why he desires for us to go into the wilderness. Because it's a time of strengthening. How many know that when you're depleted of everything, man, it's like, oh, either you're going to survive or you ain't going to survive. Either you're going to crawl up in a ball and you're going to die, or you're going to be strong to the finish. I'm going to give it every last thing that I got. You know what? If I got to take my last breath, you know what? Taking a crawl or reaching out in faith, you know what? Then so be it. You know what? Because I'm striving for something. I'm strengthened in my inner core by the relationship I have with God. You know what? And I ain't ever going to give up. No matter what's going on in my life, you know what? I'm not going to give up. That's something that I've learned, you know what, over time and having a relationship with the Lord. You know what? I just can't quit. No matter if I even tried to quit, God don't let me quit. He says, I didn't raise no quitters. Amen. And he drags you along. You're like, man, I don't like this. I don't like this. He says, I don't care. Let's go. You got to go forward. Why? Because I love you. But the sad truth is that most Christians don't even have a passion for him. Most Christians don't even have a passion for God. And when I say passion, you know, I mean like a deep desire. A desire to be those that are drawn into the wilderness to be intimate with the Lord. You know, I desire to be drawn into the wilderness, Lord God. I desire to come off of the mountain, Lord God. I desire to come out of the valley, Lord God. I desire to go into the wilderness, Lord God, because I need intimacy with you, Lord God. I need to be strengthened. I need to be renewed. I need to be refreshed and made alive again, Lord God. I need to see you, Lord God, and not the ways of the world. I need to see you and not me. I need to see you through your eyes so I can see things clearly, Lord God, because I'm being confused. That we're living in the last days and church ain't about me and it ain't about you. It's about him. Amen. You know, we strive so hard to do programs and do outreaches and do things to try to reach the people. You know what? And we forget all at an expense that we're losing intimacy with Christ. You know what? If you want to reach the people, you got to get intimate with God. You know what, the Apostle Paul and all the men that I read about in the Bible, you know what, even women in the Bible that I've read about, you know what, didn't have to go out there and try to grab things. You know what, they were drawn unto them. You know what, God will bring them. God will draw them. If we spend time with God, God will bring them. You want to be successful. You want to have a great ministry. You want to have great outreaches. Amen. You want to see people saved. You want to see your family saved. You get saved. You get right with God. You get intimate with God. Stop worrying about what everybody else is doing and what everybody else says and what everybody else thinks. And you love on God so he can love on you. Remember that God wants to love on you, church. How many of us here this morning have allowed self to get in the way? Come on now. How many of us allowed self to get in the way here this morning, church? Come on. We have. And we can either run from the truth or we can face it head on. Amen. How many of that when you run into a brick wall head on, it don't feel too good? Whew. Man, it's going to ring your bell. It's going to shake everything inside of you, man. It's going to feel like things are being torn apart. You're going to feel like you hurt in places you've never hurt before. And that's what God wants us to do. God wants us to stop running from the truth and run into the truth. Amen. So that way it could hit us so hard that, you know what, man, there ain't nothing else you can do but let it change you. Because you're so broken. Ooh, man, that it brings restoration and healing to your bones. Amen. That's what the Word of God does. Hallelujah. Do you trust in God this morning, church? Man. You know, when we first came to the Lord, we were head over heels for Him. Man. Remember? I remember you guys had them stinky old clothes because you guys used to be partiers or hang out at the bars or whatever. So you decided to go wash all your clothes and, you know, go buy you a new bottle of cologne so you can smell a little good. Try to make it look good. Huh? Coming to church in your high heels and whatever, you know what I mean? Oh! Guys coming in, you know what I mean? All buffed up in the spirit. Oh, my Lord. Man, but remember when you were head over heels for Him, man? When you came to church, everybody was your brother. Everybody was your sister. You know what? Everybody was, God bless you. I love you. You know what, man? I love you. I love you. And then over time, what happened? Whoo, man. Man, I don't know about this ministry thing. I don't know about church. I don't know about these people, man. The pastor wants me there all the time, man. I thought I'd just come one Sunday. That'd be good enough. And now, man, Wednesday too? Friday? Sunday and the street ministry? Outreach? Now they want me to volunteer? They want Stop it. Stop. We got to fall head over heels in love for the Lord once again. You remember that? I'm telling you, remember when you first fell in love with that somebody? Man, I do. I'd spend my whole check. I thought I was a boss baller. Son, man, whatever you want. And then the rest of the week, I'm like, man, I should have never did that. Jeez. And then the phone rings. Hey, what's up, girl? What's up? Yeah, what you need? Hey, mom, let me borrow $20. My girl needs something. Remember? She would call you, can you come over here? You take off running. Meet me at third period. Meet me at lunch. Meet me at the flagpole. Meet me over here. Right away, run and drop it. Can't go with you, homie, right now. I'm going over here. You fell head over heels in love for somebody. And whatever, you know what, anything, you went and you did it. Whatever it was, no matter, you put everything else on hold. Why? Because you love this person. How many of you love God? Give Him praise this morning. Amen. This message isn't to condemn. This message is to uplift. This message, you know what, is to realign and prioritize, you know what, our walk with God, because we all fall short of the glory of God. But you know what? We need to fall head over in heels with love of God again. You know what? He has to become our number one priority. You know what? When He calls, we need to come a running. Amen. Amen. No matter what's going on. I'm sorry, boss. Overtime ain't happening this weekend. God comes first. I love God, not money.
That's right.
Man, the bills are always going to keep coming. Guess what? I'm waiting for the time when the rapture takes place. Why? Because you could take the mortgage. You could take the debt. You could take the messed up car. You could take it all because I don't need it.
That's right.
I'm leaving all that garbage behind for something eternal. Man, my chanclas ain't going to wear out no more, man. I'm going to tell the Lord, I just want them Jordan slides, bro. That's it. Just give me them Jordan slides. I'll be cool walking around heaven. Says, take off your sandals for you're on holy ground. Sorry, Lord. What's up? Yee! Man, kicking it with Jesus. Man, we're going to fall in love with God again.
Amen.
How many of us, we fell in love with the wrong things?
Come on. Amen.
And right now, we're head over heels for the wrong things.
That's right.
How many know that the enemy is, you know what, he's the father of all lies? Confucius say, He brings confusion. He brings chaos. He brings all kinds of stuff into our lives, and we don't know whether we're going or coming, but we need to fall in love with God all over again. Because what happens when we're not, our focus isn't the same as it once was. How many of us, our focus needs to get back on Jesus? Amen. Not on us, but back on Jesus. Man, when our focus gets back right, you know what? Things will get better. But how many of us right now, you know, we pay more attention to sports. We pay more attention to activities and friends, as well as the work of the ministry. Oh, he mentioned ministry. Yeah. It's not just, you know, what worldly things that, you know, that are out there. Ministry could be a worldly thing too if you don't do it the right way, if you're doing it for yourself and not for God. Church could become worldly and not godly. That's why they call it religion and not relationship. It's got to be a relationship church. And instead of things being exciting, they become bothersome. How many of you guys woke up this morning? Ah, man. I really don't feel like going to church today. Huh? My neck, my back. Huh? What else hurts? Huh? Come on now. We have every excuse in the book. We got more excuses than Webster's Dictionary. I mean, more definition. Uh-huh. More excuses than Webster's Dictionary has. For why we don't do, why I don't feel like this, why I don't want to do that. You know what? Why don't you do what you want to do for the Lord? Are you tired? Are you hurting? Are your priorities out?
Come on.
Let me tell you what's happening is our relationship with God has been put on hold. Our relationship is being strained. And our love for God is dying.
Oh.
Do you understand what ministry can do to pastors and to teachers and to evangelists and to different types of people out there, even parents?
Yep.
If your eyes ain't on Jesus, and if you don't love Jesus more than your kids, if you don't love Jesus more than your spouse, if you don't love Jesus more than your pastor, if you don't love Jesus more than the world, you're going to be strained. You're going to be stressed, man. Our priorities have to get back. You know what? Your love for God is dying.
Come on. Right.
Come on, church.
Come on.
We can't let the lights go out.
Nope.
We can't let it go out. It's got to burn bright. How many know you can't let the flame go out on the fire of the altar of your heart? And the only one that can keep it burning is you, because God placed it there.
Yeah.
And he says, don't let it go out. He says, fan the flame. Fan the flame. What are you fanning the flame with? Are you smothering it? You know how the Indians send smoke signals? Man, there's a fire burning there, and then they take a blanket and they place it over it to snuff it out. And what happens is billowing clouds of smoke come up and the flame begins to die down. I mean, you know, most of us, we're just all puffs of smoke.
Come on.
Instead of a burning fire. That's why most people don't want to be around us, because we stink.
Okay.
You know what? When Meshach, Shadrach, and Abednego were in the burning fire, they came out and they didn't smell like smoke. They were unscathed. But Jesus was in there. Why? Because their love for him was more intense than anything else. You know what? That's what has to happen in our lives. Our love for Jesus has to become so intense than anything else. You know what? That people desire to be around us. That people desire to see the Jesus in you. You know what? Not, oh, we're going to church again. I don't want to go to church. I want to play Xbox, Sexbox. Huh? Come on now. Oh, many Christians get comfortable and stop pursuing God and just begin to maintain. It's cool as long as I go to church on Sunday. You know, when I first got saved, man, I was a drug addict, an alcoholic, a whoremonger, man, you name it, dude. I was every sin in the Bible. And then some. There was no word for what I was in the Bible. They didn't mention me. I'm a heathen of all heathens. And I remember when I gave my life to God. Man, there was no stopping me from going to church. There was no stopping me from talking about Him. Man, my Bible went with me everywhere. I was on fire and excited. Man, there's a revival on there. Over there, I'm going as long as it ain't on my church night. Man, there's something going on over there. I'm going, man. As long as it concerns Christ. Man, there's a barbecue. They're having beer. I ain't going. Why? Because that's worldly. You know what? I want to do what God has me doing. Oh, what do you want me to do? You need me to clean bathrooms, Pastor? You need me to pull weeds? You need me to do this? You need whatever you need me to do. Whatever. I'm here. But now, then we're cool, right? After a while, man, I don't get high no more. You know what? I don't beat my wife up no more. I don't do this anymore. I don't do that anymore. You know what? But man, I go to church on Sunday. That's good enough. I'm okay. I'm comfortable. Then the fire begins to extinguish. Never goes out, but you know what? It just gets in there and it just begins to smolder because it's suffocating. And I could just imagine God, man. When am I? You know what? People no longer chase after God. But they set their spiritual value system based on what other people do and how they live their lives. Well, brother drinks. You know what? So it's okay for a brother to drink. Why? Because Jesus drank wine. Don't be so stupid and get you a Strong's Concordance and go look up the word wine in the Hebrew in context and understand that it means grape juice. It does not mean alcoholic beverage. If you look up alcoholic beverage in the Bible, it always mentions strong drink or fermented drink. When Jesus was on the cross, He did not have a strong drink. He did not have a fermented drink. They gave Him wine, juice. Stop using the Word of God to twist it so that way we can use it for our sinful lifestyle when that's not what God wants to do because it's insanity. Come on, church. We must stop seeking God for benefits and blessings in exchange for not being intimate. And what happens when we don't become intimate with God? We're easily misled. And we believe everything YouTube says. Do you know who the creators of these platforms? Satanists. Satanists. But that's all right. What the devil meant for evil, God will make it good. Amen. Turn it around, turn it around, turn it around. But you know what? We need to get intimate with God and understand, you know what? That God is greater than anything else out there. And we can't be misled. Let's be honest, church. We pat ourselves on the back for spending time in prayer. I made it to prayer, Pastor. Good for you. Should be seeing you every prayer night. What, you want me to give you a pat on the back? You want me to give you a freaking blow pop or a lollipop? What do you want, sucker? You ought to be here all the time. Not just when you feel like it. Oh, I did a good job, Pastor. I came to church all week. So? Think I care? I care about being intimate with God. That's what I care about. You know what? And it's not, Lord, oh, I did a good job. You know what? I don't tell myself anymore, Lord, I did it. Oh, I'm so proud of myself. God, I did it. God, I did it. No. You know, when I pray, I usually ask God to give me His eyes so that way I can see like He does. That's one of my main prayers. Out of all my prayers, the main thing, Lord, besides, you know what, wash me in Your blood, give me Your eyes and Your ears. The eyes are number one. And for most of us, you know what? God is reduced to a source of help in our times of need. You know, anytime we need something, we go to God. God, I need this. God, I need that. God, I need this. God, help me. God, help me. But if we could see through His eyes, we would realize that we were attempting to use Him instead of love Him. Come on now. That's what God showed me when I told Him, let me see through Your eyes. And my prayer began to change because he says, why are you trying to use me? Why are your prayers so selfish, Leon? Why are your prayers always for something that you want me to do for you or what you want me to do for somebody else? Why isn't it for my love? Just to have eyes for you. Just that I have a heart for you. Just that I have a desire for you. You know what? That I wouldn't long or want anything else, my God, but you. Because you saved me. You set me free. You're the reason why I'm still alive. You're the reason, not me, not my friends, not my family. You're the reason why I rose out of that hospital bed. You're the reason why I survived that car crash. You're the reason why I survived molestation. You're the reason why I survived suicide. You're the reason why. He has a story to tell through you. We overcome him by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. When did you get comfortable, Christian? Man, we let everything else get out. We let the flesh get out of control. We let the flesh overpower the spirit. You know what? But he loves us too much to leave us deceived. And that's God. That's the God we serve. He don't want to leave us deceived. And just like he did for the multitudes, he'll do it for us. I want you to go with me to John chapter 6, verses 22 through 26. Let me know that what God did back then that he can do today, because he's still the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. Amen. Praise God. John chapter 6, verses 22 through 26. I want you to understand something. Jesus knows our true motives. On the next day, the crowd that remained on the other side of the sea saw that there had been only one boat there, and that Jesus had not entered the boat with his disciples, but that his disciples had gone away alone. Other boats from Tiberias came near the place where they had eaten the bread after the Lord had given thanks. So when the crowd saw that Jesus was not there, nor his disciples, they themselves got into the boat and went to Capernaum seeking Jesus. And when they found him on the other side of the sea, they said to him, Rabbi, when did you come here? And Jesus answered them, truly, truly, I say to you, you are seeking me, not because you saw signs, but because you ate your fill of the loaves. Jesus knows the true motivation behind our actions. And when the multitudes of people came seeking him, he knew that all they wanted was another meal, another free meal, hence blessing. You know how many Christians just want a free meal, just want blessing? Lord, bless me, Lord, bless me, Lord, bless me, Lord, bless me. They didn't come to seek Jesus here. They came for a free meal. You know how many people just come to church for a free handout? I heard that church gives vouchers to the hotel. You know what? I heard that church has a food bank. I heard that church does this. I heard that church does that. Well, why are you going to that church? You going to that church for a handout, or you going to that church to find Jesus? Because Jesus will supply your every need according to his riches and glory, is what the Bible tells me. You know what? I ain't going to have to go searching for a meal. Why? Because my refrigerator is going to be full of food, because my eyes are on Jesus. You know what? I ain't gonna have to worry about bouncing checks and doing all that. Why? Because my finances are gonna be in order. Why? Because my eyes are on Jesus and I love Jesus more than anything else. I ain't gonna have to worry about getting a phone call from Pastor. Oh, I miss you and I love you, and come back and where you been? Why? Because my eyes are on Jesus and I love Jesus. Amen. Amen. You know how many people looking for a freebie? Then in seeing and understanding the signs, a sign was given, and it gives discretion or information. And it doesn't point to itself. I mean, that a lot of us were given signs. I want you to understand, when you're given a sign from God, it doesn't point to you. It points back to him. It's not your desire and what you want. Oh, Lord, give me a sign if I should buy this brand new car. You're not going to get one. That's your choice whether you want to buy a brand new car or not. That's your debt if you want to take it on. God ain't going to say, bling, 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 I want you to buy it. It's going to say, no, stupid, donate it to the church. They can use it to go pick up people if you want to waste money like that. Eee, andale, but I want it. Everybody wants a new car. Man, there's plenty of other people that need new cars. We can just donate them to them. Amen? But it don't point to itself. Signs don't point to itself. They always point to Jesus. Do you know people who only call you when they need something?
No.
You already know. You look at the caller ID. Híjole. Your wife's looking at you. You're like this. The great debater. What are you doing? Answer it. I don't want to. Why? Because I know what they want. You get those people, I say, you already know they call. Pray for me, Pastor. No. So the only time they call me is when they want me to pray for them. They don't call me for anything else. Man, you want some frijoles, Pastor? Híjole. Sure. Beans, the magical fruit. The more you eat, the more you toot. The more you toot, the better you feel. So eat beans with every meal. Hallelujah. You know, but it's always about what you could do for them. I get those calls all the time. I hear it in the church all the time. It's only for their benefit. Only for their benefit. And it's when there's complaining behind it. That's when it's for their benefit. You know what? When they're joyous about it, cool. We don't mind helping. When you complain about it, don't ask me to help you do anything. Don't ask me to help you clean the church if you want to be complaining about how the church is clean. Clean it yourself. Or don't clean it at all. You complaining about the key. Ain't the key God? Anybody who wants to clean the church, you know what? Just get a key. Come clean the dying church. Be searching for somebody for a key. That's ridiculous. Freaking stupid attitudes in this church. They need to change. Get their eyes back on Jesus. It's not for their benefit. It's for God. You know what? Are we serving God for selfish ambitions? Or are we serving Him out of love? Oh, Lord. Come on. Why did you start serving God? Because I didn't want to be a drug addict no more. Because I didn't want to lose my wife and my children. You know what? Because I didn't want to die. That's why I started serving God. Selfish ambitions. But something had to change in my life. It's no longer about, you know what he can do for me. It's about what I can do for him. Here's a telltale sign that you're serving God for self. Anytime we are focusing on self, complaining will ever be present. If you're involved in ministry right now and you complain about your position, it's because you fell out of love with Christ. I don't know how else to put it. If you complain about having to go to church, you fell out of love with Christ. If you have a hard time loving your spouse, if you have a hard time loving your children, if you have a hard time loving strangers out there, you fell out of love with Christ. Man, I hear people complain about the most ironic things. Salsa. That's not the way my family makes it. Well, then don't come here. Go to your family's house and eat salsa. Jeez. Well, that's not the way I do it. Well, so what? You're not doing it. Shut up. I'm doing it. Why do you care how I'm doing it? Dale, do it then, since you could do it better. You know what? When trouble or difficulties come, because they do, we start complaining. Yep. Because of selfishness, difficulties continue, and we complain and complain and complain. This is too hard. I don't have time anymore for myself. Isn't that the whole reason why you gave your life to God? Because yourself was the problem? And God is trying to get you to die to self? You don't need to hang out with yourself. You need to go hang out with the brother at the church, the pastor over here or over there. Not yourself. We're our own worst enemy, church. Man, we talk ourselves down. We talk ourselves up, man. Oh, yeah, you going? Yeah, I'm going. Oh, I'm not going. Changed my mind, I'm not going. But we complain about everything. We complain about our jobs. I don't know about you, but the world is going into a big recession. You haven't even felt it yet or seen it yet, man. You're like, oh, man, there ain't no ramen noodles or cereal. That ain't nothing. Imagine, you know what? Remember when they shut down all the jobs when COVID hit? We're up there again on the red level. Guess what? They're going to go and they're going to say, and it's going to be different the next time. Nobody's going to work. They're going to shut down the whole infrastructure. And what are you going to do? I can't collect unemployment. I can't depend on Uncle Sam and all them to give me free money anymore. What are you going to do? You better love Jesus. Because he says, I've never seen my people begging for bread. Instead of complaining about the situation, you know what? We ought to be praising him. Woo, man. There ain't no ramen noodles and no cereal on the shelf. You're coming soon, Lord. Hallelujah, you're coming real soon. Going down the freezer aisle and you see all them atheists in there. You know God's coming soon, right? That's why there ain't nothing in the frozen aisle. You better get right. Walk off into the next aisle. What's up? Man, you can witness all day long in there. On fire for God. Instead of complaining. Man, you was going to get them hash browns too? So I was too. Stupid place. They ain't got them no more. What's really going on? I'm going to go to Safeway. Now, y'all stay wherever. Don't go to Safeway. That's why I got to go find all my stuff at Safeway because y'all don't go to Safeway. I like Safeway now. Man, everything's at Safeway. Y'all keep going to King Super. Stay at Safeway. Amen. I want you to go with me to Exodus chapter 15, verses 20 through 21. You know what? People get excited for God, and then something always, it always happens. How many of you guys always get excited for something, and then the next day you're like, ah. Man, you were excited for the party all week. Remember when you were in the world? Man, that's all you heard was, you're at work. It's almost Friday. Man, then you go do whatever you do, and then Monday, and you're like, I should have never did that. I feel horrible. Oh, why did I do that? I should have went to church. I know I was going to go to church, but man, I did myself instead. I mean, that's typical guys and sometimes girls too. They're like Houdini. They disappear. What's wrong? I'm mad. And then they disappear for a whole week and they come back. Oh, I don't feel so good. Then Miriam, check this out. The prophetess. The sister of Aaron. There's a Mexican song, says, Mexican song. Sevrum, Sevrum. Amen. It took tambourines in her hand, and all the women went out after her with tambourines and dancing. And Miriam sang to them, sing to the Lord, for he has triumphed gloriously. The horse and his rider he has thrown into the sea. Excited.
Yes.
Man, they brought through the Red Sea, man. They walked through on dry ground, man. Man, let's celebrate. God is good. Yeah. Man, God brought my husband home. Yeah. God brought my children home. Yeah. God delivered me from drugs. Yeah. We're all excited, man. We're on the other side. And then what happens? Something always happens. People get excited for God when it's for their benefit. Yep. But what about when God wants you to get excited for him and not things? Excited for him and not things. You know what? Him parting the Red Sea, that was a thing. This? The Red Sea? I just went. And it was, that ain't nothing. And you wanted me to do that. You wanted me to save your life. Lord, save us. Fíjate, mira, check it out, go. Oh, God, you're so good. Yes, thank you, Jesus. And then what happens? Hard times come. And when there's hard times, complaining begins. People always forget. See, that's the problem. It doesn't matter how big it is or how great it is. People always forget how good God is. You know that God does things for us that nobody else does? And God's been showing me this over the last couple weeks. Not of anything else that anybody else, you know, people may have used, God may have used people along the way, but God gets all the glory. And I'm amazed. I said, man, God, because as I'm seeing through his eyes and I'm looking and I'm grateful and I'm, man, God, you're so good. Over these years, you know what, even in my unfaithfulness, even in the things that I do, man, God, you're so, so, so good, Lord. And I can't help but thank you and praise you and be grateful. You know what, man? Because I remember how I felt last year around this time. I remember what I was doing last year around this time, man. But God, it's another year. Thank you, Jesus. It's another year. Man, and we got more to come. But we got to really get on fire for God. You know, and in those dry times that are hard, when people begin to complain, it's usually always directed at leaders, family members, and friends. See, right here, they were praising, but just a chapter later in 16, right away, they began cursing Moses and Aaron. That's Aaron's sister. She said, look here, chump. Man, you brought us all the way over here to die, sucker. I hate you. I want to kill you. I told all the homies to kill you, too. They don't like you. He's like, man, I didn't even do nothing, man. I'm just God's spokesman. Why are you mad at me? See how many don't be a friend of the world? That's what the scripture tells us. Why? Because we're going to be, you know what? It's because of the Jesus in us that the offense comes, that people see things in you. You know what? That they're going to slander you, that they're going to talk about you. But where's your focus going to be, church? You know what? The Israelites did the very same thing. They lost their focus. It wasn't on God. It was on Moses and Aaron. And they began to complain and they forgot how good God was. But what they were really thinking was that the Lord had let them down. And Moses saw right through them. You know, that's what they were really thinking. You can blame pastor. You can blame your husband. You can blame your spouse. You can blame your kids. You can blame life. You can blame your job. You can blame all these other things. But I want to tell you what you're doing in the spirit. You're blaming God. Go with me to Exodus chapter 16:8. It says, your complaints are not against us, is what Moses says. He says, but against the Lord. You know what? Your complaints about the church not being clean, it ain't against me. It's against God. Oh yeah, the Bible says, do all things unto the Lord. You know, I don't need somebody to tell me, you know, hey, I'm going to come. No, you know what? If I want to clean it, I'm going to clean it for God. That's it. Plain and simple. I'm not going to clean it for nobody else. I'm going to clean it for God because I love God. You know what, church? The wilderness reveals the condition of our hearts, whether they're selfless or selfish. Because when you go into the wilderness and you're selfish, you won't make it. You'll give up. But when you're selfless, you'll trust in the Lord to get you through.
Amen.
Amen. Oh, my Lord. Go with me to Exodus 16. No. Yeah, go there. Go to Exodus 15:24. And the people grumbled against Moses, saying, what shall we drink? Not only did they see Red Sea experience, and now they start complaining about, you know, it wasn't food, now it's water. What else? You know, you see that in the church all the time. I'm like, my God. They come in, they're like, oh, I'm just excited to be here, man. The Holy Spirit brought me here. But what about the carpet? What about the chairs? What about the parking lot? What about this? What about that? What? And in Exodus 16, verses 2 through 3, we're going to come close to a close right now. How many of you guys are ready to close? Exodus 16, 2 through 3. And the whole congregation of the people of Israel grumbled against Moses and Aaron in the wilderness. And the people of Israel said to them, would that we had died by the hand of the Lord in the land of Egypt when we sat by the meat pots and ate bread to the full You have brought us out into this wilderness to kill this whole assembly with hunger. My Lord. You know, I want you to do something here this morning. I want you to ask the Holy Spirit what's really going on in your heart. I want you to ask the Holy Spirit what's really going on in your heart. And out of love, God sends us into the wilderness, church. Out of love, God sends us into the wilderness. I want you to stand with me here this morning. First of all, before we get started, is there anybody in here this morning that doesn't know the Lord? Has maybe heard about the Lord, but would like the chance or the opportunity this morning to, you know what, accept Him into your heart as Lord and Savior? Or if not even that, maybe, you know what, to get right with Him. You know, maybe you've been doing you and you've been doing something else and you just want to see things through God's eyes again. You know, when you want to realign your heart with His plan and His purpose, you want that fire to be, you know what, reignited into a way to where it's not smoldering smoke, but it's an intense fire that's burning ever so clearly and brightly for not only you, but everybody to see. Now, that's you here this morning. I want you to come down to this altar.
Jesus, you don't owe me. And more than anything that you can do, I just want you. Oh, I just want you. Nothing else. Nothing else. Well, nothing else would do. Nothing else, oh, nothing else will do.
Nothing else will do. I just want.